I'd like to present a concept of opaque observation and its applications to secure compilation and more specifically to secure optimization. So this is a joint work with colleagues from Sorbonne University, ARM, and STMicroelectronics. So let's maybe start with a very common effect in secure compilation, which is referred to as within WIX. What you see is not what you execute, has been also very popular in studies about like debugging, software engineering, etc. And as the probably the simplest example possible in secure applications, you may consider the remasking or the cryptographic mask switching problem. The challenge here is to make sure you never unmask the key. So whenever you apply a new mask, you have to XOR it with that new mask before XORing again with the original mask. With the effect of removing the first mask. But the problem, obviously, is that compiler transformations may not respect this this priority. The compiler may notice that these are associative and commutative operations, and first unmask, like applying the XOR with M before applying the new mask. And this is obviously unsafe. So this is well known. People are dealing with this kind of problems. This is just one problem among many. That optimizing compilers feel that they are entitled to this kind of transformation. And a typical approach, there are many approaches, but the typical approach is to trick the compiler. So it's not necessarily to design a new compiler from scratch or new optimization passes that would be sensitive to every single kind of security property that we care about, but it's to try to trick the compiler and live with it. For example, in this case, introducing a volatile variable may work in some cases, but as you can expect, this is fragile. So a better approach is to try to make this property we want to preserve explicit, and obviously also to instruct the compiler to preserve that property, not only at the source level, but also preserve that property through the flow. And one additional challenge we take is we don't want to design a new compiler that has these capabilities. We want to make this the least intrusive possible and make instruct a production compiler, in this case LLVM, to behave properly in the presence of security properties like this one. So that's why we bring this concept of opaque observations. So this is an intuition that many people have had, essentially people implementing this trick to protect security countermeasures. And the idea is that you want to make the compiler aware of some values that have to be computed in a particular order. So there are two properties here. One is some values have to be computed. They have to be there in the first place, whatever transformations are applied downstream. And you also want to make sure that those computations follow some partial ordering. In this case, the example is very simple. So there's basically only one observation you want to make. So one value you want to guarantee to observe. You can imagine that in more complex examples, and I don't have time to show you such examples in detail, that would actually be sequences of such observations, and the ordering these observations take is also important. So the semantics questions we are facing here is, how do we make such an observation robust to downstream transformations? And also, how do we make this compiler independent? And that's where opacity comes in. So you want to make sure that there is a concept that every compiler implementation following some basic definitions of like correctness or validity of the transformations would actually preserve this observation. And opacity is one way to hide the information that you want the compiler not to analyze as a contract between the programmer and compiler. So we introduced a very simple semantics that's inspired by LLVM, but it's also capturing abstractions slightly higher level than LLVM. So you have it's an operational semantics with states and transitions that we call events. The states capture FSA values, also general references, memory, and the program counter that's used to track the states transitions. The events are labeled with an instruction. One of the highlights of this semantics is that we really focus on I/O. So we consider that what really matters in a secure application is not so much its computations in a functional sense, but more in interaction with the environment. These interactions can be ordered, like think of streaming I/O or network communications, etc., or unordered, think of persistent storage. And the semantics correctness is defined with respect to these input and output effects. Because of this ordering of effects on input sets or output sets, depending on the type of input and output, we also induce the partial order on I/O events. So whenever we would talk about semantic correctness, we talk about preserving these I/O effects and also the partial ordering among the events. So the semantic defines the function as expected from input to output sets, and it also defines some kind of trace. So we call it an execution, which is an alternating sequence of states and events, and we are going to review what happens to an execution across program transformation. So that's the one of the keys actually of the approach we are proposing, is to try to define what happens to program transformations without identifying a specific program transformation. So we want to be as general as possible, and we want a notion that can encompass basically whatever a compiler could do while preserving semantics, even the speculative transformations, very dynamic things. So the only assumption we make is that static transformations preserve I/O and the ordering, partial ordering of I/O events, as I said. On top of that, we associate every transformation of a program P into program P prime with a so-called event map, which is a relation that relates events before and after transformation. So this relation has to also relate I/O events before and after transformation. So we define additional rules, obviously, because this is a little bit weak without more information about this map. But we're going to use this map, this event map, to prove properties of transformations with respect to the observations we want to preserve. So let's talk about observations. In brief, an observation is defined formally as a partial state. So think of a snapshot of the state of the semantics by focusing on some specific SSC values or references or memory we care about. In addition to this snapshot, we established a contract between the security expert, the programmer, and the compiler, which is that we want the compiler to preserve three things on the observation. We want to make sure that whenever an observation is made before transformation, it's still happening after transformation, except the code dies, for example, because it's not useful downstream. We want to be able to trace the observation down to machine code. So this is very important for some applications such as testing, monitoring, verification of the binary. And we also want, as I mentioned earlier, to preserve partial ordering constraints. So the same way we have ordering on I/O, we want also to preserve ordering on observations. And this is important because programmers, as I said earlier, want to make sure that some observations follow some partial ordering constraints. In order to establish this contract, we define a happens before relation that the programmer has control upon. So this happens before relation will be enforced by the compiler. We're going to see how. And so obviously it includes the I/O ordering relation, which we call I/O, because it has to be for correctness reasons. But it also has to enforce two observation-related relations, observe from, which is related to the use of an observed value, has to be preserved, and observation ordering, which essentially captures data and control dependencies over observation events. So HB, the happens before relation, is the union and transitive closure of these three steps. I don't have time to detail exactly the definition of these, but you get the intuition. The problem here is that I/O is preserved by construction, but the compilers like LLVM have no clue what an observation is. I mean, they are not meant to preserve observations. Opacity is the way we are going to trick the compiler in a robust way, in a sound way, if you want. Again, this is something that people have played with using existing like compilation mechanisms, like separate compilation, for example. But here we make it a first-class mechanism. So opacity is introduced as a single entry, single exit region of the control flow. We can have whatever like uses, computation, side effects, I/O within such a region. The only hypothesis is that it terminates. And program transformations are bound to some constraints with respect to what they can do on these opaque regions. So atomicity and isolation, so this is pretty obvious. You don't want transformations to intersperse some I/O or some effects in the middle of such a region and vice versa. And beyond that, you also want the compiler analysis to be limited in what they can do about the opaque expressions. So they can figure out what variables are used. They can figure out whether an opaque expression has side effects or has I/O effects. But it's not authorized for a compiler to go beyond that. It's not, for example, possible for a compiler to figure out the exact side effects of an opaque expression. On the other hand, the compiler can decide the fact that two opaque expressions are identical. And that's it. there's basically nothing else a compiler can do. In this case, we don't have theorems. We have actually some hypotheses. So we have axioms that describe what compilers can do in the presence of opaque regions. The first one, intuitively, so don't read the math here, but intuitively, the first one is that the event map must relate opaque events, so events associated with opaque expressions, as soon as they are connected with data or control dependencies. So it's a little bit more subtle than that. I have a next slide on this, but as soon as there is some dependent relation between two opaque events, and one of them is, I mean, the consumer is preserved, is mapped through the transformation, then the producer also has to exist. The intuition for this is that you're not going to manufacture a value produced by an opaque event, by an opaque expression, because it's opaque. So whenever it's consumed, it also has to be produced. And a similar thing with the values themselves. So whenever a value is read from or is used from an opaque expression, it has to come from that exact opaque expression. So basically, the expression has to exist. The opaque expression has to evaluate in the transform program. It has to be mapped through this event map relation. And this is the exact same value that you're going to read. We are going to use these dependencies, so these control and meta dependencies of among opaque regions, to build so-called opaque chains. And those opaque chains are going to be the architecture, basically, for enforcing partial ordering of observations. And also for enforcing the preservation of the observations themselves, because we're going to use these opaque chains to link individual observations with I/O instructions, which cannot be eliminated. The intuition is that those opaque chains are very much chains of data and control dependencies, but there is a little bit of subtlety due to transformations like conversions of data dependencies into control dependencies and vice versa. Constant specialization, which can break dependencies by just enumerating all possible values of a variable, and also instruction combining, which can merge multiple paths in the control flow and eliminating duplicated instructions. So intuitively, you can think of some minimal information has to remain on some opaque values so that the compiler cannot just get away with the opaque value completely and predict statically what's coming. So the applications of all of this is are essentially in side channel and physical attacks. So whenever you have countermeasures like security properties implemented at source level, and they don't immediately translate into I/O, but they are there to present semantics that's not functional, that's actually coming from physical attacks or interactions. So I listed a few here, and so key remasking is one. Erasure of secret data, obviously, is a well-known problem with dead code elimination. Control flow integrity, and more specifically, a few problems related with fine-grained instruction level integrity, and also loop trip count integrity. So checking that you have the right number of iterations before exiting the loop. These are the kind of problems that we can protect using these approaches. And also constant time selection, which is well known to suffer from downstream optimizations that may replace carefully crafted constant time expressions into branches, because some compiler backends know that in some specific microarchitectures, it's actually faster to have a branch than a conditional move, for example. These are things we can avoid using this opaque observation approach. So we have an implementation of this in LLVM, which with minimal changes, that was one of our challenges, our goals. We encode some the observations all the way down to the dwarf like meshing code, and so that you can actually use this information in external tools. We have both functional and performance evaluation, like validation of the compiler. For example, we can compare the performance of using tricks with our approach, which is much leaner in terms of using opaque expressions only at the places where you need to guarantee some values are observed and some partial ordering, and using I/O only in the end, for example, of some functions or some applications. So this translates into concrete performance improvements compared to the state of the art. And so just to summarize, so we have been addressing this within week effect. So we want to have the correctness of transformations with respect to security properties defined independently of any program transformation of any particular compiler implementation. And this is where opaque observations help. So we define these opaque observations as both observations and opaque expressions. We have a formal model model for these, and this model provides stronger guarantees and higher performance than the state of the art.